Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. So welcome back. We're at day two, and welcome for those of you that have come in for the first day today. So yesterday we didn't quite know what to expect as our foundation in holding the first day, but there were a lot of handshakes and smiles at the end of the day. We heard great feedback during the day on the breakout sessions. Hopefully you were stretched in some ways. Hopefully you learned new things in some ways. And that was our intention. And it only continues today, and we're really excited for today. So today we'll have an exciting day of a number of keynotes. I'll introduce our first amazing keynote address coming up now. We're gonna have breakouts, and then we're gonna have a project fair, award ceremony for the winners of our project fair, and a games night. So we're really excited for that. So we often hear that absolute property rights are central to efficient markets. Set property rights allow a market to function, and you'll get to allocative efficiency. But how often are markets efficient? And given the persistence of inefficiency, especially in the case of monopolization, holdouts over land, what do we have to think about? So we're lucky to have an expert to answer some of these questions and to talk about some of these considerations. So Alicia Holland is an assistant professor of political science at Princeton University. Her work is in politics and political economy, particularly in Latin America. She has written a book fairly recently, her first book, Forbearance as Redistribution, The Politics of Informal Welfare in Latin America, examines how the tolerance of property law, violations by the poor, such as squatting, street vending and electricity theft, or what she calls informal welfare, has slowed the development of formal welfare programs in Latin America. And she had an article version of this that was award-winning in 2017. It won the Heinz Ulau Award for the best article published in the American Political Science Review. Her work has been featured quite widely. So she was in the American Political Science Review, American Journal of Political Science, Comparative Political Studies, Latin American Research Review, and Perspectives on Policy. So clearly a tie into radical exchange ideas with this speech. And please join me in giving Alicia a big round of applause and welcome.
To the Colombian side of the border, even today, you would see this. You'd run into a dirt wall. So Colombia had not built its portion of these infrastructure projects. And this is a story that's replicated across the Colombian border and also within Colombia. So for instance, here's another border project, the Rumichaca Crossing, where Ecuador built this six-lane highway stretching into Colombia. But when the Colombian president ran for re-election in 2014, he actually used photos of the Ecuadorian side of the border to advertise that he was going to complete his promise and build these projects. Now, if I just told you this story, you might think that Colombia is governed by a left-wing populist politician who hates the business community and expropriates private property. But this is actually Rafael Correa, who was the president of Ecuador during this period, and built large-scale infrastructure projects, despite the fact that he is a left-wing populist who hated the business community. In contrast, Colombia was actually governed by Juan Manuel Santos, who's from one of the wealthiest families in Colombia, has close ties to the business community, and has a strong respect for private property rights. And yet Colombia can't build infrastructure. And this puzzle goes beyond these two countries. So across the world, we see that property rights increase economic development, but oftentimes really complicate the development of infrastructure projects. So just to put some figures up for you, if you've ever taken an economic development class, you might have seen a relationship like this. What I'm showing you here is a pretty standard measure of property rights on the horizontal axis. And then on the vertical axis, I'm showing you a pretty standard measure of economic development, GDP per capita. And what we see is that wealthier countries tend to have really strong property rights. But when we look at this relationship between property rights and infrastructure development, we see something quite different. So basically, our relationship flattens or even reverses. So again, on the horizontal axis, what I'm showing you is a standard measure of property rights. And on the vertical axis, I'm now showing you investment in infrastructure as a percent of GDP. So countries with stronger property rights, like Colombia, actually spend less on infrastructure. So what I want to talk about today is this question of how property rights affect the development of public works or infrastructure. And I really want to stress the role that private property rights play in undermining infrastructure projects and leading many countries, especially in the developing world, not to finish the projects that they start. So in Colombia, there's a great saying that the only thing worse than a white elephant is half of a white elephant. So you get tons of undone projects. I want to use this example of property rights undermining infrastructure to think more broadly about what are actual radical solutions to rebalance the relationship between private property and public works development. All right, so let me give you a little bit more of the background on this project. So many economists think of the role in property rights in promoting investment efficiency. So as Jeff said, property rights are thought to be the key to economic development, and I would say also the key to infrastructure development. And this really comes through two channels. So first, property rights are thought to reduce transaction costs. So as long as we know who owns what in society, we can bargain to an efficient allocation of property. This goes back to the Coase theorem for you guys who have taken an economics class. But again, the key idea is we just need to know who owns what in society. The second role of property rights is to increase investment security. So if I know that I own my home or my business, I'm going to invest more in developing that property. So through both of these channels, we should see property rights improving economic development outcomes and leading to the provision of infrastructure projects as well. But there's another role for property rights, which Weil and Posner really stress in their book, which is essentially the effect of property rights on allocative efficiency. So when you have strong property rights, it might actually increase the transaction costs. A property owner can basically refuse to sell their property to the government or to someone who could put it to a higher value use. Strong property rights also open the door to a series of what I call opportunistic behaviors. So these are the ways that property owners can actually take advantage of their monopoly rights over property to extract resources from the government or somebody else who might want to use that property. And I'm going to talk about three different types of opportunistic behavior today, some of which are going to be more or less familiar to you guys. So the first is the idea of a holdout problem. So this should be familiar from the United States. So here, basically, existing property owners are going to use the government's need for complementary goods to build a public work to extract higher rents. But let me give you an example of this in Colombia. So here's a case where the government was trying to build a bridge. It had purchased the property on the right side of this river, and it started building the bridge across the river. But it hadn't purchased the property on the left side of the river. So what do you guys think the guy on the left side of the river did? Well, he demanded a multi-million dollar payment. And if the government didn't pay him that amount, it was gonna have half of a white elephant. So it paid that guy $7 million to buy the other side of the riverbank. So that's a holdout problem. A second type of issue that can develop is what I call infrastructure trolls. So if you're like me and you grew up in the 1980s, you might think of trolls as these dolls with multicolored hair and the little jeweled belly buttons. If you're like my students and you grew up yesterday, you might only know about internet trolls. But I want to use the term troll in a much older sense, of the Scandinavian fable of these monsters that lived under a bridge and waited for the little goats to pass to extract money from them. Or an even better analogy is to the idea of a patent troll. So basically, patent trolls purchase intellectual property, knowing that it's going to be needed for future innovations, as a way to get money out of those innovators. In the context of infrastructure, what this means is that unaffected individuals are going to purchase or occupy property that the government needs for a public work in the hopes of some payout. So let me make this a little bit more vivid, going back to Colombia. So in 2015, the Colombian government was trying to build a new transmission line in the Buenaventura region. It planned this project in virgin forest land, and the red lines, which I'm sorry are a little faint here, show where the transmission line was supposed to go. Now, 1 year later, the government came back to this property and saw this. Does anyone know what's going on here?
Those houses?
Yeah. Houses. Basically, 1,200 people built little tin shacks precisely in the route needed for this infrastructure project and demanded a payoff of $12 million, which was more than this project was worth, so it was canceled. So those are infrastructure trolls. Third type of problem that develops is what I call a scope expansion. So these are cases where actually communities use their power to obstruct or even veto infrastructure projects as a way to ask for other goods that they want. So this could be a health clinic, it could be a school, it could be jobs, it could be cash payouts. And basically, governments are compelled to pay these communities off when they're trying to build infrastructure projects. And just to give you a sense of this logic, here's a project manager from a road project in Colombia. And he says, what will cost me more, to delay the project or agree to everything that the communities ask of me, even if it doesn't have any rationale? It's an issue of speed. The state has to resolve the issues so that companies can build. So if the population says, I want a Ferris wheel for my community, then the state says, here's your Ferris wheel, I don't care how you operate it. And unfortunately, I couldn't find a picture, but there is a community that actually got a Ferris wheel. So this is not just a made-up example. All right, so the question is then, how does a property system shape the likelihood of these types of behaviors? And how do we compare different property systems? So many people talk about this idea of weak versus strong property rights. And usually what they have in the back of their mind is the contrast between what we might call a statist or socialist property system and a liberal property system. We might classify these systems based on three major rules. The first is the question of who actually owns property. So in a statist system, the state is the underlying owner of property. You can think of a country like China, where the Chinese government owns all property and individuals are basically leaseholders using the property. That's a big contrast to the United States, where we think that individuals are the fundamental owners of property, and the state can only intervene in your property in very exceptional circumstances. The second key rule is essentially how governments compensate property owners when they try to develop public works. So state systems tend to only pay property owners the administrative value of the property, what the state essentially can see of the property value. So this often is a tax value. Sometimes in the case of China, it's actually just the productive value of the land, so how much you actually yield from the particular property. In liberal systems, in contrast, governments pay fair market prices. So if the government needs to take your land, there's going to be some commercial assessor who comes in and determines what the market value is. Another way systems differ is in whether you have a right to exclude the government from using your property. So in statist systems, again, the state is the fundamental owner of the property, and so usually property owners have pretty limited rights to appeal the decision to use the land for a different purpose. In the US, we tend to protect property owners through the court system. So property owners can question whether they're getting a fair market price and maybe even the public use purpose of the project. Now, we can see how the statist system is not great if what you're trying to do is develop businesses or invest in your house or things like that. It creates much more uncertainty for individual property owners. But if the state is trying to build something, this is a great system. You're going to have minimal opportunities for individuals to object to the state's use of your property. In contrast, liberal systems like the United States tend to get a lot of holdout problems. There's also a third type of property system out there, which we'll talk a little bit more about today, which is what I might call a communitarian system. And this comes a little bit closer to the ideas in the radical markets that I'll end with. So here the idea is that the owner of property is not just individuals, but also involve communities who create social value for property. In addition, these systems also tend to recognize people who don't have full property rights. So in many developing countries, a big issue are informal property rights, where people don't have all the documents and therefore might not be able to claim full possession of their property. These systems also use a different notion of value. So when the government needs to purchase land for a public project, they're not just going to pay the objective market price. They're going to consider who owns the property. And in particular, if the owner of the property is low income, the government might actually need to pay that person much more. Because even if a house is just worth $2,000, what the government is taking from the person is a place to live. And so they need to compensate people up to the price of getting a new home. Lastly, in terms of exclusion rights, communitarian systems tend to give groups some voice over the provision of public projects. This usually involves a simple majority veto, where communities are going to vote in favor or against a given infrastructure project. Now again, this provides greater protections for property owners and for a more diverse set of property owners. But it also opens the system up to the host of opportunistic behaviors that I described. So I know this is a little bit abstract, so let's put a little bit more meat on the bones of these different property systems. So let's start with an example of a statist system, which is Ecuador. So Ecuadorian property rules go back to the military regime of the 1960s, and basically they say that the state is the underlying owner of all land in the country. And when the government wants to build a public project, it only has to pay people the tax value of their property. Now the problem with that in many developing countries is that people actually self-report the tax value of their properties. And what are you going to tell the IRS? Well, you would tell the IRS your property is worth much, much less than it actually is, because then you would lower your tax bill. And the probability that your land actually gets taken from one of these projects is pretty low. So people understate the property value and then get paid almost nothing when the government comes to take their land. In addition, your only right to appeal how much the government is paying you and the use of your land is to basically file a claim with the Ministry of Transportation and Public Works. But in the past 25 years, not a single person has won one of these appeals. So good luck. And what does this mean in terms of the development of public projects? Well, in some ways, there's minimal societal opposition to these projects. So let me give you an example where one community actually tried to resist. So the government was expanding the Pan-American Highway, which is the most important highway through Ecuador. And it went through this little town of Lasso, where basically the property values way understated the commercial value of the land in this town. So property owners tried to resist. They staged a protest. And basically the president said, good luck. I'm not even going to pay you those low property values. Instead, I'm going to move the highway. And this town basically became a total ghost town because the highway was the only commercial activity that came through the town. And the Secretary of Planning was very explicit that this was a way to prevent societal challenges to public projects. So she said, you know, if we allowed property owners to extract from the government, then it would happen with everyone. We had to be very firm because of the incentive effects. As a signal to the country, it was a very important case. So the government knew the possibility for societal opportunism and basically tried to send a signal to prevent this. And across projects in Ecuador, what we see is that land poses a minimal challenge to building public projects. So these statistics aren't great, but basically what I'm plotting here is just how much land the government needed to acquire for public projects in the last couple of years. And here's a longer time series that shows how much land the government actually bought. And what you see is that these lines perfectly overlap, because the Ecuadorian government can easily purchase the land that it needs for public projects. And so if you talk to people in Ecuador, like the Minister of Transportation, who's now in jail for corruption, what she'll tell you is that land isn't a big deal in the country. Why would we let a few people stop such a tremendous social good? The collective good has to prevail. The state ultimately creates and can take away property value. So that's a statist orientation towards property rights, which is pretty terrible for business development, but is terrific when the government goes to build public works. This is a big contrast to a country like Colombia. So Colombia has a communitarian system of property rights that dates to the 1991 Constitution. So the government was trying to demobilize one of the large guerrilla groups in the country, aiding M19. And the system that emerged basically recognized that the country needed to think about the role of more informal property rights in the country. So many people had been displaced from the Civil War and therefore didn't have all the documents to show their property claims. The government also recognized the claims of communities over property, and more specifically, Afro-descendant and indigenous communities. So this is a more inclusive definition of property owners. In addition, the government proposed a system of redistributive compensation in the case of property taking. So the Colombian Constitution has a right to housing, which means that if the government tries to take the property of somebody who has a pretty minimal home, it actually owes that person up to the value of a social interest house or a government-provided house. In addition, in terms of exclusion rights, Colombia has a class of very large, powerful landowners who basically were worried that the left was going to come to power and expropriate all of their property. So they protected their property rights through the court system and a strong judicial appeal process. In addition, the government included a set of rules around prior consultation. So essentially, this involves the government's requirement that it has to actually consult ethnic communities about whether to conduct one of these large infrastructure projects. So how does this play out? Well, first of all, Colombia has major problems with holdouts. So I'm going to talk about one highway project, which is perhaps the most important in the country, that goes from the country's large port on the Pacific in Buenaventura to its third largest city. And as the government started to build this highway project, it ran into a very resistant property owner who owned this tourist stop known as the Parador de Buga. Now, the government offered this property owner $700,000 to sell this tourist stop along the existing highway. And the property owner said, no thanks, I'll take you to court. Can anyone guess how much the judge ordered in compensation for this property? Just throw a number out there.
7 million, excellent.
That is exactly what the judge offered.
So I'm not a property assessor, but that seems pretty high.
So the government, of course, had to appeal this decision, which took 15 years to go through the court system, during which time the construction was totally stopped. But the government had to appeal because, as the president of the infrastructure agency said, the government has to avoid that each time that the state conducts an expropriation, a property owner can inflate the assessments to take advantage of the state and stop the construction of highways. Now, the second issue that emerged in this project involved infrastructure trolls. So when the government started, it needed about 900 parcels of land. When the project was supposed to be done, about 9 years later, it still needed 250 parcels of land. And during this period, another 277 land invasions, or essentially people building these little houses in the middle of the project, emerged. So this is kind of like Zeno's paradox, where basically the government is advancing in its work of buying the land, but the goalposts keep moving farther and farther away. And the people who invaded this land tended to be pretty low income, who had basically heard a correct rumor that the government would pay you about $30,000, or the price of a government social interest house, if you built a little tin shack in the middle of the highway route. And so as the head of the planning office puts it, you know, it's people who don't have their needs totally covered. That a large infrastructure project comes, so people think, there's gotta be money for me, no. Let's make ourselves affected, let's invade to get it. So this is one of the most common phrases that I hear in my field work. You have to make yourself affected and get something from the government out of these projects. Now the last issue that came up are scope expansions. So basically the government is required to consult communal councils, which are basically the political bodies that represent minority communities in Colombia. And there were three communal councils recognized in the root of the project before it started. But during the construction process, 9 new councils formed, which were linked to this woman, Rosita Solis, who is lovingly referred to as the spoke in the wheel for her ability to jam up bureaucracy and use it to the advantage of Afro-Colombian communities. Now, these communities made very legitimate demands that they basically wanted to get things like health clinics and schools and jobs out of these projects. What the government ended up doing was actually paying communities an average of $13 million to agree to these infrastructure projects. And what's amazing about this sum is that these communities are very small. They're usually about 20 families. And yet they were able to use their rights to block the project to get quite large payments from the government. All right, and if we look more broadly across Colombia, what we see is a lot of opportunism that basically stalls these projects. So here what I'm showing you is how much land the government needed for its infrastructure projects, and then in blue, how much land it actually acquired by the time the project was supposed to be done. Now, if we go back to that figure of Ecuador, I was showing you the land that was bought in the same year that the government tried to build the land. This is showing you about 10 years later that the government still is trying to buy substantial portions of land. And over all projects in Colombia, land and social issues delay construction by an average of about 6 years and cost the country about 0.5% of GDP each year. This is enormous given that Colombia only spends about 1% of GDP on infrastructure projects to begin with. All right, so what I tried to stress today is the different ways in which countries organize property rights. At one extreme, we have statist systems like Ecuador that basically privilege public development of infrastructure projects to the expense of individual property owners. At the other extreme, we have communitarian systems like Colombia that take into account individual property rights and provide stronger protections, but at the expense of actually finishing public infrastructure projects. So of course, the question is there a better resolution to this trade-off between private property rights and social development projects?
What I want to talk briefly about is what the radical solution might look like. So Weil and Posner propose a system of communal property ownership where basically people have much more partial rights over their property. So individuals would self-assess the value of their property, and at any point, the government or other individuals could purchase property at that price. So this is a much more partial notion of property ownership. It also has underlying it a different system of valuation. So if you think of a liberal market system like the United States, where what people get paid is the market value of their property, the real problem is that many of us actually value our property at higher than market prices. So maybe I love my house, I have some idiosyncratic memories attached to it, and therefore the market price is below what I actually think my house is worth. Well, in this system, basically people would get paid their subjective market valuation for their property. So I could say my house is actually worth much more than the market value. Now, a radical system might also give communities a different set of ways of participating in infrastructure projects. And here the idea might be to combine partial property rights with a system like quadratic voting. So communitarian systems like Columbia give communities the right to participate in decisions about how property is used in the community. But they also basically give people majority veto, which means that maybe not everybody in the community opposes the project. Maybe the project has broader benefits from the nation that aren't being taken into account in those local decisions. So quadratic voting might provide another way to involve communities without actually blocking these projects. And again, the promise is that a different organization of property rules also undercuts some of these opportunistic behaviors that I talk about. So again, part of the mechanism design is to reduce the incentives for things like holdout problems or some of the scope expansions that I talked about today. Now, one question is, how far off are we from some system like that? Is this just crazy talk? Well, one of the reasons to study comparative politics like I do is to look for different ways of organizing institutions across the world. And I think some elements of a radical system already exist. So for example, the idea of this partial property rights system rests on self-assessment. In many countries in the developing world, this is already how property is valued. Property owners have to self-assess their property values. The problem is this is usually only done for tax purposes. And the probability your land is taken for a public project is much lower than the usual tax incidence on you. So it is possible to imagine a self-assessed system of property rights. It also may seem crazy to have other individuals buy your property at any moment in time. But even in the US, we allow private corporations to use the power of eminent domain. The problem now is only corporations have that right. So what if a broader set of individuals actually could purchase land to put it to a different set of uses? Now, the huge problem with this type of system that we'd have to overcome is what to do when most people can't actually afford to price their property at its subjective market value. So I may love my house, but I might not have the economic means to actually pay taxes on how much it's worth for me. So until we have a much more radically redistributive system, it's hard to imagine how this property system could work. In terms of collective decision making, governments recognize the need to consult communities about public infrastructure projects. The problem is that communities are often defined in a pretty rigid geographic sense, or in Colombia, it was actually an ethnic sense, where people who didn't belong to those ethnic groups weren't consulted. So some of the big questions out there is, how do you think of a more emergentist definition of who's part of the community? Who should be consulted in these projects? And also, how do you balance kind of local affectation versus the national desire for some of these projects? So one of the open questions about implementing something like quadratic voting is who should get voice to participate in those votes in the first place? Only the affected community? The entire nation?
Maybe we distribute credits in different ways to essentially reweight local and national interests. So let me just end with a last word on why this topic is so important. So many advanced economies, including the United States, built large infrastructure at a time before they actually recognized liberal rights, and more specifically, the rights of minority communities. So if you think of the national highway system in the US or many of our large-scale transit projects, they were built disregarding the rights of Black and Indigenous communities. We no longer can do that. In the same way, many developing countries are trying to build infrastructure at a time of fuller democratization. So they are struggling with this tension between private property rights and public infrastructure development. So in the US, if we think about projects like the high-speed rail from San Francisco to LA that's been proposed, one of the biggest issues is how to actually acquire the land for those projects and how to allow local communities affected to participate in decisions about whether it should be built or not. Likewise, in the developing world, many cities are growing extremely rapidly, but at a time when urban development has already taken place. So how are governments going to actually get the land needed to build projects that could be in the greater public interest? This is why there's such a need for radical solutions to this tension between property rights and public development, and I hope that's what you guys will all help in thinking about. So thank you so much.
I'm actually blown away by that for you to traverse different examples in the real world and then show us that, like you said, it's not just imagination here with some of these ideas, and then the impact of these ideas, right? Governments have been working on these things for centuries, right? And to introduce new mechanisms that can change the distribution of things. So thank you so much for exemplifying that. So a message that Glenn wanted to pass on, actually, which is, I think, fantastic, is that today we really want to emphasize our unconference sessions as well. So I would invite you to look at the schedule of the unconference sessions today and get involved. So those will be in the partial commons, and this is obviously not to the exclusion of the other breakouts. There's a lot of decisions to be made on what great sessions to go to today. But we want to hear your voices. We want to hear you engaging with ideas. We want to hear you listening to ideas like Alicia just gave us, and really grappling with them and understanding, wow, that can actually be put into place, and what can I contribute to that conversation? So go have the conversation with your now peers around you and get involved with that. And now I'd like to transition to our first breakout sessions. If you check your booklets, you're going to find out where those are, and hope you enjoy them.